Mr. Skor, what do you see as the major challenges in LNG and the new energy landscape?
I think it's the interesting part is this the start of the super cycle discussion of the commodity prices going up, you know, on the back of the Ukraine conflict, and also the other commodities increasing. You know, the end of last year, we saw LNG rates on both the Asia and the Atlantic side being nearly topping $300,000 earnings a day. Mm-hmm. We're now back down to sort of below that 100, but actually we're starting to see that go up as tonnage is tight, new trade lanes are happening, and we could actually see those rising up. I think the interesting point to remember is typically freight is not that well known in Interside. So it's normally about 10% less of a delivered price to going from A to B. But when it's at high of 300s or 3,000, it's like 45%. Mm-hmm. And some people go, what is that context? And I think that's where we're going to go into. Commodity prices are expensive, freight is going up, and I think that's going to be a long term because of the capacity. The new builds are coming in, but in a nice steady mode. So I think the LNG sector are in a good place at the moment.
So how far do you think this is going to last? I mean, you said that this may be a long term, but could you please pinpoint where this is going to end?
I think it's definitely 1 to 3 years. I think you could see that peaks and troughs. It's going to be very volatile. Mm-hmm. Certain routes are going to be better. But I think, this should be around for the next 1 to 3 years. I mean, the slots which are available in the shipyards are booked up to 2025. Steel prices are really, really high, and I think an LNG at the moment is $230 million US. So you've got to, if you're going to go for the investment, you've actually got to have that sort of the backing from the financiers and so on and so forth. Yeah.
Having said that, the LNG though is part of the carbon fuel, so we are in the middle of decarbonization, or we should be.
Yeah.
How do you think this will actually affect the decarbonization process, bearing in mind the IMO regulations?
So I think actually it's a really good point. The LNG is, we talk about it as a transitional fuel, but you've only got about 2% of the mix at the moment, the fuel mix. It's going to go up to maybe 6% by 2030, which is still quite small. And then hopefully, if you roll forward to 2050, maybe actually a third of that. It's going to be there. You've got the LNG fueled ships, or the LNG ships are the majority of the bunker demand, about 80%. But actually, when you move forward to 2030, you could actually see it's down to 40%. So you've got a really good order book coming in. The container industry is really driving that. They've got 36 LNG dual fueled ships at the moment, another 155 on order. So they're really driving that. And I think the customers want ESG focus, the public sectors, all the owners here really want that. But the challenge is about the pricing. You've got EU ETS talking about the carbon tax side, but because the commodity price going really high, actually then the bunker price for LNG is really, really high as well. Mm-hmm. So even though from well to wake for the LNG is actually better for the environment, less CO2, so you would want them to burn, the LNG dual fueled ships are burning low sulfur, which actually is worse for the environment. But we need the pricing mechanism. How do we go about that? The carbon tax, even with a $200 carbon tax added onto that, still means you should burn low sulfur, because it's still $5,000 cheaper a day for, say, an Aframax than it is to burn LNG, which needs to change. A bit like you in Greece, you've got unleaded, a lot higher than diesel. In UK, you've got diesel, which is a lot higher than unleaded, but the actual process and to make it is, diesel's a lot cheaper. So I think that's from an LNG perspective, but ammonia, we've got a lot of ammonia-ready ships being built. I think of the order book, it's about 7.6%. I think people talk about ammonia as being the net zero, and we're talking about green ammonia. Hydrogen is definitely going to be there for the shorter haul, like the batteries. But ammonia and methanol are sort of the ones which are going to lead the way in the deep sea. But there's no fuel availability. The infrastructure is not there. So in the near term, these next 1 to 3 years, we've really got to go for embrace LNG, biofuels, and actually really sort of work out the pricing mechanism so it's fair across the board. And yeah, that's what I believe.
So what you're actually saying is that ammonia or hydrogen may be the future fuel. However, the investment needed to be actually made by the ship owners, does it actually qualify for the profits that they need to make in order to survive, to be sustained?
I think with the ammonia, the engines aren't going to be available until 2024. So you're seeing a few ships being ordered. I think the onus shouldn't be on just the ship owner. It's a whole collaborative approach. And I think you were been talking about with the banks, the investment, the charterers. Everybody's got to invest into this and actually come up with a good reason and rationale why they should go into the ammonia. That then brings in the bunkering teams. Now you've got bunker providers building green ammonia on a pilot level. That needs to accelerate. But you then, it's that chicken and egg. You need other the technology to be there. That's just scalability. And that's the issue for what we're talking about. The scalability is not there yet, but by the time we get to 2050, I think it will be.